Now it's time to get into the Word. Are you ready for the Word? Amen. All right, let's get into the Word. Today we will be coming out of the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 24, verses 36 through 44. And I will be reading to you from the New King James Version of the Bible. And I ask all who are physically able to please stand in reverence of God's holy word. And the word reads, "But of that day and hour, no one knows, not even the angels of heaven, but my Father only. But as the days of Noah were, so also will the coming of the Son of Man be. For as in the day before the flood they were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage until the day that Noah entered the ark and did not know until the flood came and took them all away, so also will the coming of the Son of Man be. Then two men will be in the field, one will be taken and the other left. Two women will be grinding at the mill. One will be taken and the other left. Watch, therefore, for you do not know what hour your Lord is coming. But know this, that if the master of the house had known what hour the thief would come, he would have watched and not allowed his house to be broken into. Therefore, you also be ready. For the Son of Man is coming at an hour you do not expect." This is the word of God for the people of God. You may be seated. Let us pray. Father God, I feel your presence already in this sacred, holy place. I ask that the words of my mouth and the meditations of our heart be acceptable, because you are truly our strength and you are truly our Redeemer. And we ask this in the unmatchless name of Christ, who paid it all, and to all to him we owe. So let us come together with one heart, one mind, and lift up the name of Jesus. And the church of God said, Amen. Today's message is entitled, "Be Ready, Be Willing, and Be Able." Be what? Ready, be willing, and be able. As we celebrate the first week of the Advent season, let us reflect and prepare for the coming of Jesus' birth. My hope and prayer is that our preparation is more intentional this Advent season by opening up our hearts and our minds and remembering the true reason for the season. Today, we are blessed with a fresh start of our Christian calendar year. Today is the first Sunday of a new Christian year, and we ought to be glad about it. As we embrace another Advent season and anticipate with great joy the coming of a babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a lonely manger, a savior for all humanity, the Prince of Peace, the Kings of Kings, the Lord of Lords, who is named Jesus. The season is about spiritual gifts that Advent brings to us as an intervention, an opportunity for a fresh start, and changes in our intentions. Intentions are very important, because whatever is in your mind and heart, it comes out. So you want to make sure that when you move in the right way. If you want your work to be a sweet aroma to the Lord, it has to begin in love. You understand? It begins in love, in peace, with joy and hope. It's an opportunity for a fresh start as we renew our minds and open up our hearts and progress towards true discipleship. Because that's what it's about. Once you are a part of the body of Christ, you are in an active phase. You are out working and being the hands of Jesus Christ, the hands and the feet of Jesus Christ. Because we are here to make disciples for Jesus Christ for the transformation of our world. Does our world need to be transformed? It's in dire need of transformation. So it's in dire need of you to be doing what God has destined and ordained for you to do, to bring it out into the world. This experience is emotional. This experience is life-changing because this experience affects the soul. And through the grace of God, His amazing grace, and the Holy Spirit moving within us, this is what gives us hope. As we remember and seek the wonders of His love and the mysteries of our faith, church family and friends, as we move into the holiday season, we celebrate the year's harvest. Even though we've had to deal with one thing or another this year, we are here. And we have a harvest to celebrate. For every day is a day of thanksgiving. And in everything, we are to give thanks. This is what the Bible reads, right? It is a blessing to take a portion of our harvest and share it with others so that we can be connected to one another, partake in the yield of the season, and fellowship with one another. To be faithful over a little and be able to share with others is how we build the kingdom, because God gets the glory. God gives the increase. God can take your little and multiply it until there is overflow. Won't He do it? Has He done it for you? And He'll do it again, because that is the type of God that we serve. Our giving to the building of God's kingdom is an outward expression of our love towards Him, demonstrating our obedience and our gratefulness for His provision He provides for us each and every day. Had the Lord not been on my side, tell me, where would I be? He wants us to be ready. He wants us to be willing, and we know that we are able because He created us in His image as we watch and we wait in faith. During Noah's time, God of Israel, who brought creation out of chaos, now allows chaos to return. Due to the wickedness of humanity being great on the earth with violence and corruption. You see, the people turned away from God. They got so busy with their lives that they forgot to thank the Creator for the life that He has blessed them with. So they turned away from God. A divine act of judgment was warranted because of the sinful nature of the people in their thoughts and in their hearts. God decided to blot out all living things upon the earth, and He regretted ever creating humankind, all creatures and all living things. Noah found God's favor and was a righteous man of this generation because he walked with God. Church family, we have to walk with God. Don't want to go anywhere without him. I want him with me in daylight and in night. I want him with me wherever I go, because with him, all things are possible. Your protection, your guidance, your provision, whatever you need, God's got it. Noah found God's favor and was a righteous man. Like I said, he walked with God. Noah and his wife and his three sons and their three wives were spared from the devastation of the flood upon the earth. The waters from the flood were upon the earth for 150 days before they receded. But God remembered Noah, his family, and the wild and domestic animals. Just like the waters came up on the earth, the Son of Man will come back and claim all people who are called by his name. There are four things that I want you to grasp from this message. One, Christ will come again. Therefore, we must be prepared and ready for the second coming. The mission of the church is a life and death situation. It's life and death work. That's why you can't just sit and say that everything is all right with you and not be concerned about your neighbor. We are here to be active. We are here to be a voice. We are here to be a source of God's amazing grace and his renewed mercies. We are to share the gospel of Jesus Christ, not with just to everyone, not just to who we feel should have it. Jesus Christ came for all, and all means all. The lovable, the unlovable, the ones that are on the margins, the ones that have not. God is for everyone. We must remember the sacred worthiness of every soul, especially now when we are seeing an eroded moral compass of our society. We are seeing things that are not natural. Parents are to love their children, not kill them. Children are to love their parents, not kill them. We are to love God and to love our neighbors. If it was easy, what would be the reward? And the thing is, we have this eroded moral compass within our community as well as in the faith, community of faith. So we need to re-examine why we are here and stay focused on the goal and stay focused on the mission. The Word of God declares that Jesus came and died for all. You see, one man died for everyone. Jesus was wounded for all of our transgressions and crushed for our iniquities. And by his wounds, we are healed. That's what Isaiah says in the 53rd chapter. That puts everyone in the same boat. No one is greater or lesser than the other in the eyes of God. And that should be making us happy because we're all the same because our God is impartial. Human life is human life, and everyone is worth saving. Number two, the Son of Man's coming will be swift and surprising. When we are engaged in everyday work, there's no indication that that day would be any different from yesterday or the day before. Life goes on, except in that instance, it doesn't. And we, as the body of faith, have just experienced that. Death will come quickly. We don't know the day, nor the time, nor the hour. But I do know this, we must be ready, for life is full of swift transitions. The third issue, or the third point, is the Son of Man will divide people into two groups. When he comes, you're not going to have time to get your life straight. The time to get your life straight is now. In time of peace, you prepare for war. So that means that you've got to be willing, you got to be ready, willing, and able now. Because at the second coming, the faithful will be immediately taken up to the heavenly reward, and the unfaithful will be left behind to their fate of torment. And the Bible says the gnashing of teeth. I don't want that torment. I want God's full glory. I want to experience everything that he has set before the beginning of time for me to experience. Not only do I want it for myself, but I want it for my family and my friends. Because we're talking about a place where every day is Sunday and the Sabbath has no end. We're talking about where there's praise and angels rejoicing. A place of peace, a place of hope, a place of joy, a place of rest. The word of God says that all nations will be gathered before him. He will separate them one from the other as a shepherd divides his sheep from the goats. And he will set the sheep on his right hand, but the goats will be on the left. Then the king will say to those on his right hand, "Come, you blessed of my father. Inherit the kingdom prepared for you and from the foundation of the world. For when I was hungry, you gave me food. When I was thirsty, you gave me drink. When I was a stranger, you took me in. When I was naked, you clothed me. When I was sick, you visited me. When I was in prison, you came to me." So this is in Matthew chapter 25. This is the word of God. This is what it reads. Number four, so we better be what? Ready. We better be ready. That is the point. We had better be ready. If we focus on the readiness, we need not worry about the details. We can trust Jesus to get the details right. Preparation and readiness is foundational in discipleship. You shall love the Lord God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. This is the first and the greatest commandment, and the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. What this means, everything that he gave us in the law, and what all the prophets have said, these are the greatest. Loving God and loving one another. Yet it's so hard. This is what he wants from us. We must love God with our whole heart. Can't say it enough. Because these are two things, but they're hard to come and make true. But they are possible. We are to prepare in this earthly life to receive our crown and enter the gates of heaven to dwell with the Lord our God. We want to be relevant and significant by adding to people's lives, not taking away. Just like Jesus adds to our lives, carrying God's light in love in dark places. To be aware and sharing the love of Jesus Christ knows the importance of being in a right relationship with the Father. For a man is incapable of removing their own sin. Man can just repent their sins and plead for forgiveness, but only the blood of the Lamb, the blood of Jesus Christ, can cleanse them of their sins. We must take action by abiding, by living and obeying his commandments, because our eternal reward is based upon how we live in this earthly life. Kingdom living is now, as well as eternal. Our eternal reward is based on how we love others as we love ourselves. Our eternal reward is based on our faith, for without faith, how can we please him? So get ready while you still have time, because the word of God declares he comes quickly. And you do not know the day, nor the time, nor the hour when he will call you into your eternal rest. So get to know him while you have a chance. Ask God to remove the scales from your eyes and the hardness from your hearts, so when your time comes, you will have a flourishing finish. This is a season-defining moment. Will this season be your winter, or will this season be your spring? The choice is yours. Choose this day to whom you will serve. Just remember, Jesus said, "Behold, I am coming quickly. My reward is with me to give to everyone according to his work." Jesus is the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. Blessed are those who keep his commandments, that they may have the right to the tree of life and may enter through the gates into the city. Revelations 22. Be ready, willing, and able. Know that Christ will come again. Know that his coming will be swift and surprising. Know that he will divide people in two groups, the sheep and the goats, so that we better be ready. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Thank you so much for watching this video. Please be sure to like, comment, subscribe, and share. Don't forget to connect with me on social media, Pastor Johnny Simpson Jr. on Facebook, at Pastor J. Simp Jr. on Instagram and Twitter. Thanks again for watching, and God bless.